When looking at the world today, it's very obvious to understand why the Father commanded us not to be of this world. When we look at many of the practices, holidays, and rituals that we participate in, the reasons we should not be of this world become so clear. A majority of the holidays and customs that are celebrated in the world today have pagan and occult roots. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 11 says, "And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them." And this is why I'm making this video. Over time, we have accepted pagan and occult practices that have been marketed to us as being fun and harmless, but that is so far from the actual truth. The celebration of Halloween is something that truly emphasizes this point. The reason is because the history of these things is not properly taught to us. We are only taught about the fun things, like wearing costumes and going around getting candy from the neighborhood, but we never have been taught where all these things come from. We tend to just accept it as being harmless fun. But in actuality, the truth is, if we are ever taught the truth about these things, it's a fact that a majority of society will not partake in them, even those that don't believe in Elohim. There has always been an agenda to blur the lines between good and evil. Also, an agenda to initiate the world into the occult and to accept the things of Lucifer. After you understand more about Halloween, you will clearly see that this agenda is truly in the end stages. Let's begin.
What is going on, my brothers and sisters in Christ? All right. Well, today it's another Genesis 11 study, and we are going to discuss on pagan holidays. All right, so we discussed on paganism, and we discussed on the basis of monotheism. All right, so it's just two categories, guys. It's pretty much God's chosen ones, all right, the holy nation, Israel, and the Gentiles, which is the rest of the world, the paganism. All right, so basically anybody can get grafted in if they just choose to follow Yeshua, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Okay, and how to do that is get a relationship with him. Okay, you have to further your intimacy and further your relationship with the Lord. Okay, it's not just a one-time thing or here and there. Okay, I'm sure you don't want to see your wife here and there. I'm sure you want to see your husband every day. Okay, that's the same way the Lord wants to have a relationship with you. Okay. And before we dive into the word of God, let's open up with a word of prayer, shall we? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, Holy Spirit, thank you so much, Lord, for allowing us to be together as a family spiritually, Lord. Thank you for bringing us together at your divine appointment. Lord, allow everyone with eyes to see, ears to hear, and understand what's being taught to them. Everything has been corrupted into what you really want us to know, Lord. Help my brothers and sisters that really want to know the truth, and that's you, and help them to further understand the real you and not the one that the world tried to present you as. In the name of Yeshua, we pray all this, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Uh-oh, another one of those studies. Don't believe what I post. Research what I post. Dear God, fix me when I'm the problem and protect me when I'm not. In Romans 15:4, such things were written in the scriptures long ago to teach us, and the scriptures give us hope and encouragement as we wait patiently for God's promise to be fulfilled. In Isaiah 28:10, he tells us everything over and over, one line at a time, a little here and a little there. 2 Timothy 2:15, work hard so you can present yourself to God and receive his approval. Be a good worker, one who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly explains the word of truth. And then Psalms 23:3, he renews my strength, he guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name. And then Psalms 25:11, for the honor of your name, O Lord, forgive my many, many sins. And then Psalms 31:3, you are my rock and my fortress, for the honor of your name, lead me out of this danger. And remember Proverbs 18:3, spouting off before listening to the facts is both shameful and foolish. And Ephesians 5:11, take no part in the worthless deeds of evil and darkness, instead expose them. All right, now open up to Ecclesiastes chapter 3. We're going to read this whole chapter. A time for everything. For everything, there is a season, a time for every activity under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to harvest, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to cry and a time to laugh, a time to grieve and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace and a time to turn away, a time to search and a time to quit searching, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be quiet and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, and a time for war and a time for peace. What do people really get for all their hard work? I have seen the burden God has placed on us all. Yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. So I conclude there is nothing better than to be happy and enjoy ourselves as long as we can. And people should eat and drink and enjoy the fruits of their labor, for these are gifts from God. And I know that whatever God does is final. Nothing can be added to it or taken from it. God's purpose is that people should fear Him. What is happening now has happened before, and what will happen in the future has happened before. Because God makes the same things happen over and over again. The injustice of life. I also noticed that under the sun there is evil in the courtroom. Yes, even the courts of law are corrupt. I said to myself, in due season, God will judge everyone, both good and bad, for all their deeds. I also thought about the human condition. How God proves to people that they are like animals. For people and animals share the same fate. Both breathe and both must die. So people have no real advantage over the animals. How meaningless. Both go to the same place. They came from the dust and they return to the dust. For who can prove that the human spirit goes up and the spirit of animals goes down into the earth? So I saw that there is nothing better for people than to be happy in their work. That is our lot in life. And no one can bring us back to see what happens after we die. All right, brothers and sisters, open up to 1 Samuel chapter 15. I'm going to give you some history on our Hebrew brothers and sisters, our Israelites. Okay, so that way y'all can understand that this nation that God chose is our example. All right, and not only that, y'all need to understand that Christ had to do all these examples. So He is our example perfectly in harmony. So we need to focus on what He says and understand what they're doing in these examples of what we're reading. All right. So, 1 Samuel 15, Saul defeats the Amalekites. One day Samuel said to Saul, "It was the Lord who told me to anoint you as king of His people Israel." Now listen to this message from the Lord. This is what the Lord of Heaven's armies has declared. "I have decided to settle accounts with the nations of Amalek for opposing Israel when they came from Egypt. Now go and completely destroy the entire Amalekite nation. Men, women, children, babies, cattle, sheep, goats, camels, and donkeys." So Saul mobilized his army at Telaim. They were 200,000 soldiers from Israel and 10,000 men from Judah. Then Saul and his army went to a town of the Amalekites and lay in wait in the valley. Saul sent this warning to the Kenites, "Move away from where the Amalekites live, or you will die with them. For you show kindness to all the people of Israel when they came up from Egypt." So the Canaanites packed up and left. Then Saul slaughtered the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, east of Egypt. He captured Agag, the Amalekite king, but completely destroyed everyone else. Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and goats, the cattle, the fat calves, and the lambs. Everything, in fact, that appealed to them. They destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. The Lord rejects Saul. Yeah, that's totally saying everything that God told him not to do. He told him what did God tell him to do again? Let's see what Saul told Samuel, what the Lord told him to say. This is what the Lord told him to do. It was the Lord who told me to anoint you as king of his people Israel. Now listen to this message from the Lord. This is what the Lord of heaven's armies has declared. I have decided to settle accounts with the nations of Amalek for opposing Israel when they came from Egypt. Now go and completely destroy the entire Amalek nation. Men, women, children, babies, cattle, sheep, goats, camels, and donkeys. All right, what did his people do? All right. Saul, verse 9, Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and goats, the cattle, the fat calf, and the lambs, everything, in fact, that appealed to them. Yeah, he didn't listen. All right, so remember what I said. Remember God, you know, he's not being cruel. These are like Nephilims, okay? The Amalekites go all the way back to Exodus, if y'all go back and read that. But we're not going to get on that study right now. All right, so let's continue. The Lord rejects Saul. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I am sorry that I ever made Saul king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my command. Samuel was so deeply moved when he heard this that he cried out to the Lord all night. Early the next morning, Samuel went to find Saul. Someone told him, Saul went to the town of Carmel to set up a monument to himself. Then he went on to Gilgal. When Samuel finally found him, Saul greeted him cheerfully. May the Lord bless you, he said. I have carried out the Lord's command. Then what is all the bleating of sheep and goats and the lowing of cattle I hear? Samuel demanded. It's true that the army spared the best of the sheep, goats, and cattle, Samuel admitted, but they are going to sacrifice them to the Lord your God. We have destroyed everything else. Then Samuel said to Saul, stop. Listen to what the Lord told me last night. What did he tell you, Saul asked. And Samuel told him, although you may think little of yourself, are you not the leader of the tribes of Israel? Then the Lord has anointed you king of Israel. And the Lord sent you on a mission and told you, go and completely destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, until they are all dead. Why haven't you obeyed the Lord? Why did you rush for the plunder and do what was evil in the Lord's sight? But I did obey the Lord, Saul insisted. I carried out the mission he gave me. I brought back King Agag. But I destroyed everyone else. Then my troops brought in the best of the sheep, goats, cattle, and plunder to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. But Samuel replied, what is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering the fat of rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft. And stubbornness is as bad as worshiping idols. So because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Now that was a king, all right? And we're supposed to be royal priests, kings and priests. And this generation. All right. So, and here's a judge. If you guys aren't familiar with the judges, all right, there's plenty of judges, just like there were plenty of kings. All right. Samson, I'm just going to pick him out. All right. Because Samson, I'm sure people know Samson. He was the man that couldn't cut his hair. He had the strength of God. All right. So, in Judges chapter 14, verse 3, his father and mother objected. Isn't there even one woman in our tribe or among all the Israelites you could marry? They asked. Why must you go to the pagan Philistines to find a wife? But Samson told his father, get her for me. She looks good to me. All right. So, and Samson was a judge. He was anointed. All right. Everybody got a problem with females. Samson was no different. Okay, and it was because of a female. That's why he lost his anointing. But the Lord gave you, go read the story. It's very great. You know, he get to kill, you know, a lot of Philistines, you know, at the end. But yeah. All right, now we're going to learn about some kings. Go to 2 Kings chapter 12. Joash repairs the temple. Joash began to rule over Judah in the seventh year of King Jehu's reign in Israel. He reigned in Jerusalem 40 years. His mother was Zebiah from Beersheba. All his life, Joash did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight because Jehoiada, the priest, instructed him. Yet even so, he did not destroy the pagan shrines, and the people still offer sacrifices and burnt incense there. One day, King Joash said to the priests, collect all the money brought as a sacred offering to the Lord's temple. Whether it is a regular assessment, a payment of vows, or a voluntary gift, let the priests take some of that money to pay for whatever repairs are needed at the temple. With the 23rd year of Joash's reign, the priests still had not repaired the temple. So King Joash called for Jehoiada and the other priests and asked them, why haven't you repaired the temple? Don't use any more money for your own needs. From now on, it must all be spent on temple repairs. So the priests agreed not to accept any more money from the people. And they also agreed to let others take responsibility for repairing the temple. Then Jehoiada, the priest, bored a hole in the lid of a large chest and set it on the right hand side of the altar at the entrance of the temple of the Lord. The priests guarding the entrance put all the people's contributions into the chest. Whenever the chest became full, the court secretary and the high priest counted the money that had been brought to the Lord's temple and put it into bags. Then they gave the money to the construction supervisors, who used it to pay the people working on the Lord's temple. The carpenters, the builders, the masons, and the stone cutters. They also used the money to buy the timber and finished stone needed for repairing the Lord's temple, and they paid any other expenses related to the temple's restoration. The money brought to the temple was not used for making silver bowls, lamps, snuffers, basins, trumpets, or other articles of gold or silver for the temple of the Lord. It was paid to the workmen who used it for the temple repairs. No accounting of this money was required from the construction supervisors because they were honest and trustworthy men. However, the money that was contributed for guilt offerings and sin offerings was not brought into the Lord's temple. It was given to the priests for their own use. The end of Joash's reign. About this time, King Hazael of Aram went to war against Gath and captured it. Then he turned to attack Jerusalem. King Joash collected all the sacred objects that Jehoshaphat, Jeroham, and Ahoazah, the previous kings of Judah, had dedicated along with what he himself had dedicated. He sent them all to Hazael, along with all the gold in the treasuries of the Lord's temple and the royal palace. So Hazael called off his attack on Jerusalem. The rest of the events in Joash's reign and everything he did are recorded in the book of the history of the king of Judah. Joash's officers plotted against him and assassinated him at Beth Milo on the road to Selah. The assassins were Jos Kar, son of Shimamith, and Jehoshabad, son of Sharmer, both trusted advisors. Joash was buried with his ancestors in the city of David. Then his son Amaziah became the next king. All right, now hop on over to 2 Kings chapter 17, and we're going to go to verse 24 and start there. Foreigners settled in Israel. The king of Assyria transported groups of people from Babylon, Kuthoth, Avah, Hamath, and Sepharvaim, and resettled them in the towns of Samaria, replacing the people of Israel. They took possession of Samaria and lived in its towns. But since these foreign settlers did not worship the Lord when they first arrived, the Lord sent lions among them, which killed some of them. So a message was sent to the king of Assyria. The people you have sent to live in the towns of Samaria do not know the religious customs of the God of the land. He has sent lions among them to destroy them because they are not worshipped him correctly. The king of Assyria then commanded, send one of the exiled priests back to the Samaria. Let him live there and teach the new residents the religious customs of the God of the land. So one of the priests who had been exiled from Samaria returned to Bethel and taught the new residents how to worship the Lord. But these various groups of foreigners also continued to worship their own gods. In town after town where they lived, they placed their idols at the pagan shrines that the people of Samaria had built. Those from Babylon worshipped idols of their god, Succoth-Benoth. Those from Kohath worshipped their god, Nergal. And those from Hamath worshipped Ashima. The Avites worshipped their gods, Nibhaz and Tartak. And the people from Sepharvaim even burnt their own children as sacrifices to their gods, Adrahamalek and Ananamalek. These new residents worshipped the Lord, but they also appointed from among themselves all sorts of people as priests to offer sacrifices at their places of worship. And though they worshipped the Lord, they continued to follow their own gods according to the religious customs of the nations from which they came. And this is still going on today. They continue to follow their former practices instead of truly worshiping the Lord and obeying the decrees, regulations, instructions, and commands he gave the descendants of Jacob, whose names he changed to Israel. For the Lord had made a covenant with the descendants of Jacob and commanded them, do not worship any other gods or bow before them or serve them or offer sacrifices to them, but worship only the Lord who brought you out of Egypt with great strength and a powerful arm. Bow down to him alone and offer sacrifices only to him. Be careful at all times to obey the decrees, regulations, instructions, and commands that he wrote for you. You must not worship other gods. Do not forget the covenant I made with you, and do not worship other gods. You must worship only the Lord your God. He is the one who will rescue you from all your enemies. But the people would not listen and continued to follow their former practices. So while these new residents worshipped the Lord, they also worshipped their idols. And to this day, their descendants do the same. All right, now hop on over to Jeremiah chapter 44, Judgment for Idolatry. This is the message Jeremiah received concerning the Judeans living in northern Egypt, in the cities of Migdol, Tahpanhes, and Memphis, and in southern Egypt as well. This is what the Lord of Heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says. You saw the calamity I brought on Jerusalem and all the towns of Judah. They now lie deserted and in ruins. They provoked at my anger with all their wickedness. They burned incense and worship of the gods, gods that neither they nor you nor any of your ancestors had ever even known. Again and again, I sent my servants, the prophets, to plead with them, don't do these horrible things that I hate so much. But people would not listen or turn back from their wicked ways. They kept on burning incense to these gods. And so my fury boiled over and fell like fire on the towns of Judah and into the streets of Jerusalem. And they are still a desolate ruin today. And now the Lord of Heaven's armies, the God of Israel, asks you, why are you destroying yourselves? For not one of you will survive, not a man, woman, or child among you who has come here from Judah, not even the babies in your arms. Why provoke my anger by burning incense to the idols you have made here in Egypt? You will only destroy yourselves and make yourselves an object of cursing and mockery for all the nations of the earth. Have you forgotten the sins of your ancestors? The sins of the kings and queens of Judah? And the sins you and your wives committed in Judah and Jerusalem? To this very hour, you have shown no remorse or reverence. No one has chosen to follow my word and the decrees I gave to you and your ancestors before you. Therefore, this is what the Lord of Heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says. I am determined to destroy every one of you. I will take this remnant of Judah, those who were determined to come here and live in Egypt, and I will consume them. They will fall here in Egypt, killed by war and famine. All will die. From the least to the greatest, they will be an object of damnation, whore, cursing, and mockery. I will punish them in Egypt just as I punished them in Jerusalem, by war, famine, and disease. Of that remnant who fled to Egypt hoping someday to return to Judah, there would be no survivors. Even though they long to return home, only a handful will do so. Then all the women presents, and all the men who knew that their wives had burned incense to idols, a great crowd of all the Judeans living in northern Egypt and southern Egypt answered Jeremiah, "We will not listen to your message from the Lord. We will do whatever we want. We will burn incense and pour out liquid offerings to the Queen of Heaven just as much as we like. Just as we and our ancestors and our kings and officials have always done in the towns of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem. For in those days we had plenty to eat, and we were all off and had no troubles. But ever since we quit burning incense to the Queen of Heaven and stopped worshiping her liquid offerings, we have been in great trouble and have been dying from war and famine." Besides, the woman added, "Do you suppose that we were burning incense and pouring out liquid offerings to the Queen of Heaven and making cakes marked with her image without our husbands knowing it and helping us? Of course not." Then Jeremiah said to all the men and women alike, who had given him that answer, "Do you think the Lord did not know that you and your ancestors, your kings and officials, and all the people were burning incense to idols in the towns of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem? It was because the Lord could no longer bear all the disgusting things you were doing that he made your land an object of cursing, a desolate ruin without inhabitants, as it is today. All these terrible things happened to you because you have burned incense to idols and sinned against the Lord. You have refused to obey him and have not followed his instructions, his decrees, and his law." Then Jeremiah said to all, including the woman, "Listen to this message from the Lord, all you citizens of Judah who live in Egypt. This is what the Lord of Heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says. You and your wives have said, 'We will keep our promises to burn incense and pour out liquid offerings to the Queen of Heaven.' And you have proved by your actions that you meant it. So go ahead and carry out your promises and vows to her. But listen to this message from the Lord, all you Judeans now living in Egypt. I have sworn by my great name, says the Lord, that my name will no longer be spoken by any of the Judeans of the land of Egypt. None of you may invoke my name or use this oath, as surely as the sovereign Lord lives, for I will watch over you to bring you disaster and not good. Everyone from Judah who is now living in Egypt will suffer war and famine until all of you are dead. Only a small number will escape death and return to Judah from Egypt. Then all those who came to Egypt will find out whose words are true, mine or theirs. And this is the proof I give you, says the Lord, that all I have threatened will happen to you, and that I will punish you here. This is what the Lord says. I will turn Pharaoh Hophra, king of Egypt, over to his enemies who want to kill him, just as I turned to King Zedekiah of Judah over to King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. All right, now hop on over to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Okay, lessons from Israel's idolatry. I don't want you to forget, dear brothers and sisters, about our ancestors in the wilderness long ago. All of them were guided by a cloud that moved ahead of them, and all of them walked through the sea on dry ground. In the cloud and in the sea, all of them were baptized as followers of Moses. All of them ate the same spiritual food, and all of them drank the same spiritual water. For they drank from the spiritual rock that traveled with them, and that rock was Christ. Yet God was not pleased with most of them, and their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. These things happen as a warning to us, so that we will not crave evil things as they did, or worship idols as some of them did. As the scriptures say, the people celebrated with feasting and drinking, and they indulged in pagan revelry. And we must not engage in sexual immorality as some of them did, causing 23,000 of them to die in one day. Nor should we put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and then died from snake bites. And don't grumble, as some of them did, and then were destroyed by the angel of death. These things happened to them as examples for us. They were written down to warn us who live at the end of the age. If you think you are standing strong, be careful not to fall. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptations to be more than you can stand. When you are tempted, He will show you a way out so that you can endure. So my dear friends, flee from the worship of idols. You are responsible people. Decide for yourselves if what I am saying is true. When we bless the cup at the Lord's table, aren't we sharing in the blood of Christ? And when we break the bread, aren't we sharing in the body of Christ? And though we are many, we all eat from one loaf of bread, showing that we are one body. Think about the people of Israel. Weren't they united by eating the sacrifices at the altar? What am I trying to say, huh? Am I saying that food offered to idols has some significance, or that idols are real gods? No, not at all. I am saying that these sacrifices are offered to demons, not to God. And I don't want you to participate with demons. You cannot drink from the cup of the Lord and from the cup of demons, too. You cannot eat at the Lord's table and at the table of demons, too. What do we dare to rouse the Lord's jealousy? Do you think we are stronger than He is? You say, I am allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. You say, I am allowed to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. So you may eat any meat that is sold in the marketplace without raising questions of conscience, for the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. If someone who isn't a believer asks you home for dinner, accept the invitation if you want to. Eat whatever is offered to you without raising questions of conscience. But suppose someone tells you this meat was offered to an idol, don't eat it. Out of consideration for the conscience of the one who told you, it might not be a matter of conscience for you, but it is for the other person. For why should my freedom be limited by what someone else thinks? If I can thank God for the food and enjoy it, why should I be condemned for eating it? So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Don't give offense to Jews or Gentiles or the Church of God. I, too, try to please everyone in everything I do. I don't just do what is best for me. I do what is best for others so that many may be saved.
Dark side is today. As we approach Halloween each year, many people jokingly dismiss it as just a secular, frivolous observance. And yet, anyone that's in law enforcement knows it's also a time that the serious witches and covens and Satanists and so forth run rampant. It is a time when people expose themselves to frivolous little games that are known among demonologists as entries. And as we, from time to time, contemplate case studies of demonology, demon possession, as were dramatized in the movie The Exorcist. Remember, that all started with the frivolous playing of a Ouija board. These are called entries. And if you want to get into more of that, we've just done a briefing package on Halloween as an invitation to the occult. And of course, part of it goes with this very closely is drugs. As the word for sorcery in the New Testament is pharmakia, the word from which we get the word drugs. It's, of course, expressly forbidden. The occult is expressly forbidden in Exodus 22, verse 18, Leviticus 20, verse 27, Deuteronomy 18, 14, and other passages. Don't have to hammer that one. The next group are the adulterers. I think we know what that is in today's society. It's glamorized by our entertainment industry and, in fact, encouraged by our federal government to our school children. And in terms of fornication, it's forbidden, of course, in Exodus 20, 14, the Ten Commandments, as well as many other places.
Take part in these things like they are fun activities where people get to dress up and kids get to get candy. But this is all about spirits and demons roaming the earth and the celebration of the dead the next day. And the more places that celebrate it, the more wicked spiritual energy that is being transmitted amongst the world. Halloween openly promotes death, devils, witches, and flagrant appearances of evil. Proverbs chapter 8 verse 36 says, "But he who sins against me wrongs his own soul. All those who hate me love death." Participating in a day that celebrates death and the dead is hypocritical of one that says they love the Father. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 20 through 22 says, "Rather, that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to demons and not to Elohim. And I do not want you to have fellowship with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Adon and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Adon's table and of the table of demons. Or do we provoke the Adon to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? I know you do not mean to provoke the Father to jealousy. It's just deception that we've been born into. Things we've grown up accepting without knowing what we were doing. But this is why he tells us not to be of this world. Because if we would follow that instruction, it would cut out a majority of the deception that we get ourselves caught up in. In the last scripture I just gave, it says he does not want us to have fellowship with demons. You can't drink the cup of Elohim and the cup of demons. You can't sit at the Father's table and the table of demons. Many people privately ask me questions, and one of them is if it's okay for their kids to participate in the Halloween celebrations at their church, because their church softens up the day and makes it about the Messiah. They don't allow the demon costumes and allow a safe place for the kids to participate without getting in with all the evil. I don't like making bold statements telling people what to do, because everybody's life is different. But let me say this boldly. Not only is it not right for you to allow your child to participate in their event, but you should not be in that church. You may take that as extremely bold, but let me explain why I said that. Go back through all that information I just went through on the wickedness of this day. Now, your pastor and leaders don't need to know all of that history. What they should know is very simple doctrine that I keep repeating. Not to be of this world. Do not be a friend of this world. I say this scripture often in my videos, but it's always worth repeating. James chapter 4 verse 4 says, "Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with Elohim? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of Elohim." You see, if your pastor doesn't hold this understanding, then they can lead you to becoming an enemy of Elohim by allowing you to embrace this world, but just tweak the obvious devilish things. And if they're wrong about something that's so obviously evil, what else could they be leading you astray with? I'm not saying that it's intentional and that they are purposely doing this, but in the end, it doesn't matter. Your church should be protecting you from things like this and not teaching a form of conformity. Just by recognizing this day and participating in it, regardless of the few tweaks you do, you are giving glory to Satan and dishonor to Yahweh. You're trying to sit at the table of the Father and of demons. First, I understand what your church is trying to do, and if it were that simple, life would be much more simpler. But we need to stay away from all of this wickedness completely, acting like the day doesn't exist. And pastors that take the role of being shepherds of the Father's people should know this. And if they don't know this, why are they shepherding the sheep? Beware of churches that are bringing conformity like this. It is not harmless. They shouldn't be changing the name to Trunk or Treat or Hallowed Be Thy Name or whatever else they want to try to use, just to replace the name Halloween. If they know the day is so wicked that they need to change the name, then they know enough that they shouldn't have any involvement with it whatsoever. And if you're a pastor who has unknowingly participated in this, please humble yourself and correct this with your flock. Let me make this clear. I'm not judging you if you have participated in this in the past. It's deception, and we all have fell for different forms of deception in our lives. This is the goal of the devil, to deceive us. So I'm not going against you for your past. I'm trying to assist you with your future and your children's. Be happy that we have been afforded more time and our time has not run out on us. We have time to correct our mistakes and repent from them. This video was made to first inform you of the things that you might not have been aware of in hopes that it leads to repentance and correction. We all are not perfect, but we need to examine our lives and look at the things that we do and partake in. The Bible, the word of Elohim, gives us instruction. And if we place it as the authority and not the ways of this world, we will cut out the amount of deception we fall prey to. The devil preys on our ignorance and lack of knowledge. He preys on the fact that we do not read our Bibles and trust our pastors to steer us in the right direction. Let me end this with clear instruction. Stay away from Halloween. Do not allow your kids to celebrate it. Don't let them dress up in costumes. If it is a problem for them, keep them out of school on that day. Do not do any trick-or-treating. Keep the light off at your home and don't answer the door when people come knocking. No costumes for you adults either, no matter how small. And no Halloween parties, not even if all your friends are going or you have the best costume. Stay out of it. You need to literally act as if this day does not exist and continue to worship and communicate with the Father. If you feel weak about something, pray about it and give it to Him. I feel that this year, 2018, there's going to be a massive amount of wicked demonic energy.
If you are a Christian and you are celebrating Halloween, it's time to stop. We are called to be set apart from the world as Christians. The world loves them some Halloween. Everything that's from the pit of hell is celebrated on Halloween, and the world loves it. Secondly, we are called to avoid all appearances of evil. How can we have one day of celebrating death, celebrating spells and witches and warlocks and ghosts and spirits and necromancy? How can we celebrate that for one day and not think that it hurts? It hurts the God that we serve. All He asks is that when we come to Him, we come to Him wholeheartedly.
You as a believer should not be celebrating Halloween, dressing up, acting up, faking up, and messing up. You are a born-again, blood-bought, Holy Ghost sanctified believer. Live like it, walk like it, declare it, and be who God has called you to be. Don't be throwing away your destiny over some clown suit and the enemy laughing at you because you're putting on a clown suit. You need to be clothed. The Bible says if you want to put something on, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. You need to put on God's armor and take off Satan's armor, because Satan is a zero, Jesus is the hero.
Jesus was the ultimate one who busted up Satan's game. And He tells us that when we trust Him, we don't need to worry about those spirits of darkness. 1 John 1, verse 5 through 7. This is the message that we have heard of Him, and we declare to you that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all.
Same thing. but let's keep going. The Druids' New Year started on November 1st, so obviously their New Year's Eve is October 31st. The Druids believed that on this night, all of the people who died in the past year would rise up and search for the passageway to the netherworld. On this night, the passageway, or veil, between both worlds was its thinnest. Their lord, Samhain, would roam the earth in search of these souls to capture them and take them to the world of darkness. To this day, some people put lights in the windows to help the dead find their way and keep Lord Samhain away from taking them. The World Book Encyclopedia states, "The Celts believed that the dead could walk among the living at this time. The living could visit with the dead." This ancient belief was even paired with the ability of some people to communicate with the spirits of the dead. And at Samhain, this was something to be embraced, even celebrated. They felt they surely could find some way to capitalize with communicating to these spirits, like gathering occult power or the spirits giving them knowledge, etc. So this is where Halloween and its customs started, with the Celtics and their pagan devil-worshipping priests, the Druids. So as we move more into history, we go to the beginning of the 7th century, where we see Pope Gregory I. The Roman Catholic Church was moving along with their world domination in the name of God, and they were now seeking a mass conversion of Britain and Ireland, where of course the Celtics are from. In order to assist the conversion, instead of doing away with the native people's customs and beliefs, the Pope adopted them. They didn't do away with Samhain. They adopted it, but changed the name. Samhain, to the Roman Catholic Church, was now All Saints' Day. In the 8th century, Pope Gregory III is said to have moved the date of All Saints' Day from May 13th to November 1st, again the same day as Samhain. He did this when he dedicated a chapel in St. Peter's in honor of All Saints. All Saints' Day, also called All Hallows' Day, Hallow Mass, or Feast of All Saints in the Catholic Church, is a day commemorating all the saints of the Church, both known and unknown, who have attained heaven. This is a day of celebration and prayer to the dead saints. This is not biblical in the slightest. In Latin America, this time is also known as the Day of the Dead, again with people praying to the dead. So October 31st, the night before All Saints' Day, also known as All Hallows' Day, is the time of the most intense activity, both human and supernatural. They believe it allows the souls of the dead to come back to earth and walk among the living on this day. This is the eve of All Hallows' Day. Let me break it down. The day before All Hallows' Day, October 31st, was recognized as All Hallows' Eve. Remember, All Saints' Day is also known as All Hallows' Day. Hallow replacing saints. Hallow as a verb is to honor as holy, but as a noun it means saint. E'en is a contraction of eve or evening before. This is where we get Halloween. Hallow plus E'en, the eve of All Hallows' Day. This is the day where people worship the dead. Halloween is a lot like Christmas. The Roman Catholic Church adopted it to appease their converts and try to place a holy name and cause around a pagan, devil-worshipping tradition. Now that you know where Halloween comes from, let's talk about the customs and practices that are associated with Halloween. Going back to the Druids, because again, this tradition comes from them, the Druids performed horrifying human sacrifices and other vile rituals during Samhain. Let there be no doubt, Samhain night was a terrifying covenant with death and with hell. The Druids believed during Samhain the mystical veil separating the dead from the living opened. The Druids taught that these Roman spirits loosed on Samhain went searching for a body to possess. Druid priests led the people to diabolical worship ceremonies in which horses, cats, black sheep, oxen, human beings, and other offerings were rounded up, stuffed into wicker cages, and burned to death. This was done to appease Lord Samhain and keep spirits from harming them. Again, Halloween has always been a celebration of death. This is also where the origin of bonfires come from. The word bonfire actually comes from bone fire, which was all that was left after the sacrificial ceremonies were ended. To obtain offerings for these bonfires, Druid priests would go from home to home asking for animals and humans. Those who gave were promised prosperity in the coming year, and those who did not were cursed and threatened.
It's Michael's holiday gift haul. Make the most of your budget this year with up to half off hundreds of creative gifts for everyone on your list.
And especially during Halloween. Halloween is the time when they are killing babies at a high rate. And I'm telling you, parents, you have to pray. Stop. What business does a Christian have with Halloween? I mean, you find Christians also putting on skeletons and they're also celebrating Halloween. Do you know how children are being sacrificed during that time? Many children die. Saints, we don't have to copy the things of the world. How can a Christian celebrate Halloween? It baffles my mind because the amount of rituals that take place during that time, and as you participate in it, you're also declaring that you're part of it. You know, because anything that is out of the word of God, where in the Bible does God tell us to celebrate Halloween?
Mm-hmm. Those are the cultures of this world.
True story.
Now, the founder of NASA, which is this.
Out in the first five books of Moses. That's what sin is, according to the Bible. So Paul says, shall we just start breaking God's laws, getting up and breaking all his laws because we're not under the law, we're under grace? God forbid. That means no. He says, no, you're not supposed to be doing that. You're not supposed to be doing that. You don't use grace as an excuse to start breaking God's laws. So now you got to reevaluate the verse prior. You got to find out, okay, what does he mean by this? What is he saying? He's not telling you that you don't have to keep the law. I'm going to give you an example of what he means, that you're not under the law, you're under grace. When Christ and the disciples came from preaching the gospel and it was the Sabbath day and they were hungry, they started picking the corn. It's unlawful to do any work. According to the law, it's unlawful to do any work on the Sabbath day. But since these brothers were hungry, they were exercising grace. The Most High is not some robot up in the sky and doesn't have any type of intellectual capacity. He understands if somebody's hungry, if it's the Sabbath day, brother, get some food. If you don't have no food, especially you've been preaching the gospel, you don't have any food at the time, you was preaching the word and you didn't get a chance to prepare any food, brother, get some food. That's what he means. You're not under the law. The law says you can't do nothing. So if you were under the law, that means you'd be sitting there looking like a fool on the Sabbath day with your stomach growling. You waiting for the sun to go down. You looking around waiting for the sun to go down. Grace, that's what he says. You're not under the law, you're under grace. That's what he means by that. But then when you read the next verse, shall we sin because we're not under the law? Christ and them wasn't grabbing corn and bundling it up to go sell it at the market next week. They wasn't just using grace as an excuse to start breaking God's laws for no reason. It was a reason why they had to extend the law of the Sabbath. They had to go outside of the boundaries on the Sabbath day because them brothers were hungry. You're not going to sit there on the Sabbath day and you see somebody dead or dying on the floor and you say, brother, it's the Sabbath day. I'm sorry, I can't do no work. You're a doctor. I can't do no work. I got to wait for the sun to go down. When the sun drops, then I can go ahead and help you. That's what he means. You're not under the law. The law is not made to have somebody in a cage. It's a guideline. It's a guideline. Sometimes things happen where you might have to go outside the guideline, but then you come right back in and go right back on the guideline of keeping the commandments. That's all he's saying, that you're not under the law. You're under grace. That's it. It's as simple as that. And this concept of grace is not something new invented by Paul. It's not something that Paul just woke up one day and said, you know what, grace. You can read about grace all the way back in Genesis. All throughout the Bible, there's grace. All throughout the Bible. That's why you're not supposed to be dealing with Paul's letters until you have understood all the previous chapters in the Bible. This is the last section of the Bible you're supposed to be dealing with. The last one. That's why Peter told you it's going to be to your own destruction. And the Most High wants to know where your heart is really at. Galatians 5 verse 17. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. So Paul is telling you that the flesh and the spirit, it's a war going on. They're contrary.
And that is, once a year, we face the dilemma, the problem, the burden of dealing with a holiday called Halloween. And it's obviously very easy to shrug this off as just another one of these quaint vestiges of days gone by. But it's interesting, I thought we would tonight explore a little bit on some of the background that will relate to decisions that you're going to have to make this year again. The celebration of the pagan festival of Halloween is now a $2.4 billion market, merchandiser's dream. And that.
And if you guys wasn't aware, this is your January holiday god right here. In Roman mythology, Janos was the god of doors, gates, and transition. Janos represented the middle ground between both concrete and abstract dualities such as life, death, beginning, end, youth, adulthood, royal, urban, war, peace, and barbarous and civilization. So yeah, Julius Caesar, emperor of pagan Rome, instituted the New Year festival on January 1st. In 46 BC, Caesar adopted the Julian calendar. January is named after the Roman god Janos. So if y'all want to get technical, biblical wise, spring is actually the new year. And if y'all didn't know, that's the reason for April Fools. All right. So this is not the new year. January is not the new year. Romans dedicated the month of January to the two-faced god Janos, which I just read to you. All right. This is the new year. Abib. All right. In Exodus 12:2, this month is to be for you the first month of the of your year. And Abib is in the month in the spring. All right. And I know, brothers and sisters, this is very, it's a sensitive topic. I used to celebrate a whole bunch of these. All right. And if you're familiar with starting off with this channel, all right, it's a lot different from what it started off with. And we actually celebrated a Vlogmas. All right. And we actually, I loved Christmas. To be honest, I loved it. All right. That was my number one holiday. But I love Christ more. All right, I'd rather listen to him than to continue celebrating what he told me not to do. All right, so pagan holidays such as Christmas, Mother's Day, Halloween, Independence Day, New Year's, Thanksgiving, Valentine's Day, Father's Day, Easter, pretty much everything in that the whole freaking year. It's an abomination to the Most High Yah. All right, not because I said it or you said it because the Most High. All right, it's because Yah said it, okay? The Lord said it. And if you're not familiar with Valentine's Day, just look this up. Look at Kilia. So my brothers and sisters, this is probably going to be multiple parts. And it's probably going to hurt a lot of feelings. And I'm, you know, like I said, it's either choose the Lord or choose the world. And clearly the Lord says, do not choose the world or you're going to die with the world. All right, you want to choose him.
It's January 1st, you know what that means. 2 months more of wintertime, and also the new year. Isn't it sort of weird to celebrate the beginning of a new year when everything's dying or dead and it's cold outside and it's bleak? Wouldn't it make more sense to celebrate in the springtime when everything's green, it's warmer, and everything's being made new? Well, that's what they used to do back in the day until the Romans changed our calendar. Yeah, in 45 BC, Julius Caesar changed our calendar to honor himself, and that's why the fifth month is named July and not Quintilis anymore, and the beginning of the new year starts in January to honor Janus, the two-faced god. No irony there, right? But before then, everyone celebrated the new year in March, in springtime, including the Hebrews. Check out where their first month was, Nisan, somewhere between March and April. And here's what Genesis 1:14 says about the calendar. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens and separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for season and for days and for years. So see guys, it's God who sets the order of our calendar, not a man. Oh, and ironically, you ever heard the expression, beware of the Ides of March? Well, the Romans celebrated the Ides of March as the first new moon of the new year, the end of their new year celebration. And it just so happened on March 15th, 44 BC, Julius Caesar was assassinated on the Ides of March. How about that? So he was killed on New Year's Day, basically, 1 year after he changed our calendar. I guess man shouldn't mess with God's calendar, huh?
Watch.
Being calm, didn't you? Let's look at the year. How many months are there in a year? 12. Exactly. How many weeks are there in a year? 52. Good. However, 12 months? Well, 12 times 4 is 48. And 52 minus 4 is 48. Doesn't take a genius to work out. We've got 4 extra weeks. And what do 4 weeks make? A month. There are actually 13 months in a year. We are being paid for 12 months' work, and we are doing 13 months' work a year. This is outrageous. This is absolutely outrageous.
Thanks. But it's really not that simple. So we all have to understand it. So what is Thanksgiving? According to the Britannica, Thanksgiving Day is an annual national holiday in the United States and Canada, celebrating the harvest and other blessings of the past year. Americans generally believe that their Thanksgiving is modeled on a 1621 harvest feast shared by the English colonists, Pilgrims of Plymouth, and the Wampanoag people. This American holiday is rich in legend and symbolism. We were taught in school that this story of Thanksgiving is that pilgrims sat together with Native Americans to share a meal and thank them for helping with a successful first harvest.
Hello, English man. I am Squatto. Perhaps we should strike a treaty between our peoples.
Good idea.
And that's what many of us feel we are partaking in. But the whole truth of that story is not quite as nice. Using this article from the New York Times, everything you learned about Thanksgiving is wrong, we can get more understanding of its history. According to the article, the Mayflower did, in fact, bring pilgrims to North America from England, which they colonized and they renamed Plymouth, Massachusetts. In 1621, those pilgrims celebrated a successful harvest, with a 3-day gathering that was attended by members of the Wampanoag tribe. And again, this is what we all think we are celebrating when we celebrate Thanksgiving. It wasn't until the 1830s that this event was called the First Thanksgiving by New Englanders, as this is how they wanted to view this day, by this event. But when you add more history to this colonization of this country, it can definitely show you why you will want to be separated from it.
American ideas about the frontier are probably sugarcoated. We want to ignore the ugly side of what was really going on. The vast majority of American Indian nations were forcibly removed from their original homelands.
It is said that the first Thanksgiving stemmed from the massacre of the Pequot people in 1637, a culmination of the Pequot War.
I remember about the massacre through my grandmother. She always talked about it as if it happened yesterday.
When you think about the history of the United States, there are a few key dates that really made a difference, where the way events were before really shifted. And one of those dates was in 1637. The English and their Indian allies attacked a fort at Mystic, Connecticut.
The massacre at Mystic Fort did change relationships between the colonists and the Indians forever.
It set the form for the taking of Indian land. And the process is repeated across the country.
The massacre at Mystic was the first time English people engaged in the wholesale slaughter of Native Americans. But it certainly would not be the last. May 26, 1637 was a day that changed everything in the land that would become America.
As the Puritans of Massachusetts Bay spread further into Connecticut, they came into increasing conflict with the Pequots, a tribe centered on the Thames River in southeastern Connecticut. By the spring of 1637, 13 English colonists and traders had been killed by the Pequot, and Massachusetts Bay Governor John Endicott organized a large military force to punish that local tribe. On April 23rd, 200 Pequot warriors responded defiantly to the colonial mobilization by attacking a Connecticut settlement, killing 6 men and 3 women and taking 2 girls away.
On May 26, 1637, 2 hours before dawn, it is recorded the Puritans and their native allies march on the Pequot village at Mystic, slaughtering all but a handful of its inhabitants. On June 5th, Captain Mason attacked another Pequot village, this one near present-day Stonington, and again the native inhabitants were defeated and massacred. On July 28th, a third attack and massacre occurred near present-day Fairfield, and the Pequot War came to an end. Most of the surviving Pequot were sold into slavery, though a handful escaped to join other southern New England tribes. The massacre of Pequot was the killing of 500 Native American men, women, and children. When they tell the story of Thanksgiving, they tell the story of the natives eating with the pilgrims, but they leave out that the ones that did not agree to the colonizing of their land were killed. They were massacred. This holiday is dressed up around a meal between two different tribes of people giving thanks. But what is not mentioned in it is that the people being celebrated were colonizers who had no regard to life that was not their own. They killed and pillaged in order to establish themselves. Their conduct will be severely spoken against today, but yet we use them as the reason to celebrate a holiday. It's said that the pilgrims extended an invitation to the Native Americans for helping them reap the harvest, but the actual truth of how they all ended up feasting together is not actually known. We know a Disney-type story of it. The English written record does not mention an invitation, and the Wampanoag oral tradition does not seem to reach back to this event. What we know is the celebration they had was an exceptional cross-cultural moment with food, games, and prayer. And we will start to focus on that point of it, the prayer aspect. These pilgrims, the New England colonists, were accustomed to regularly celebrating Thanksgivings, days of prayer, thanking God. The Thanksgiving celebration was days of prayer, thanking God for blessings such as military victory or the end of a drought, etc., things like that. This is a day about prayer, which is why it is named Thanksgiving. People are thanking God for what he is giving them. What we know as Thanksgiving is more of a tradition that does not come from Yah, but more tradition that stems from the Church of England. It is time that many believers today understand that so much of your faith in Yah has been tainted by not only the Roman Catholic Church, but also the Church of England. In the English tradition, days of Thanksgiving and special Thanksgiving religious services became important during the English Reformation and the reign of Henry VIII. Before the year 1536, there were 95 church holidays, plus 52 Sundays, where people were required to attend church and forego their work. Though the reforms in the Church of England that came in the year 1537, it reduced the number of holidays in the religious calendar to 27, the Puritan Party and the Anglican Church wished to eliminate all church holidays apart from the weekly Lord's Day, which is what many view as the Sabbath, but it's celebrated on Sunday. And they included the feast of Christmas and Easter. They were thanking their God for the harvest and the food that came the past year. Understand, the idea of Thanksgiving is a religious holiday. That's why it's called Thanksgiving. It's not secular, and though it is not a pagan festival like Christmas and Easter, being that it is religious, those who follow Yah must recognize this, because this type of holiday is actually quite pagan. What we know as Thanksgiving is a day of religious observance, set apart to give thanks for the blessings of the past year, as well as an occasion for family reunions, big dinners, and festivities in the home. Like I just showed, they like to say that the origin of the holiday was about the festival they had with the Native Americans in 1621. But in your understanding of this holiday, you must know that this type of celebration has been celebrated by pagans since the ancient times. The idea of a day to set apart to celebrate the completion of the harvest and to render homage to the spirit who caused the fruits and crops to grow is ancient and universal amongst pagans. The practice of designating a day of Thanksgiving for specific spiritual or secular benefits has been followed in many countries. Most countries celebrate a Thanksgiving Day in one form or another. Like in Australia, Thanksgiving is celebrated on the last Wednesday of November, In Brazil, the Thanksgiving celebration takes place on the fourth Thursday of November. This date there is celebrated by many families of American origin in some Protestant Christian denominations. In Germany, the Harvest Thanksgiving Festival, now please forgive my pronunciation, the Erntedankfest, is a popular German Christian festival on the first Sunday of October. The festival has a significant religious component, and many churches are decorated with autumn crops. Labor Thanksgiving Day is a national holiday in Japan. It takes place annually on November 23rd. The law establishing the holiday, which was adopted during the American occupation after World War II, cites it as an occasion for commemorating labor and production and giving each other thanks. It has roots in the ancient Shinto harvest ceremony. And in the United Kingdom, the Harvest Festival of Thanksgiving does not have an official date. However, it is traditionally held on or near the Sunday of the harvest moon that occurs closest to the autumnal equinox. And there are many more celebrations in many other countries. I want you to note, none of it has to do with pilgrims. If you research this, you will see that many countries partake in this type of religious day. This is not a secular day of eating and just gathering with family. It is a religious day that has been used for millennia to thank their gods for their harvest. For instance, as we just spoke about the United Kingdom, Harvest Thanksgiving in Britain had pre-Christian roots. Basically, before Christianity came to England, the pagan Saxons would offer the first sheaf of barley, oats, or wheat to their fertility gods. When the harvest was finally collected, communities would come together for a harvest supper. Then when Christianity arrived in Britain, many of their pagan traditions remained, and it was just wrapped around the God of the Christians. They just keep doing that. When we celebrate Thanksgiving, what we are actually practicing is Harvest Thanksgiving. The pagans in Rome celebrated their Thanksgiving in early October. The holiday was dedicated to the goddess of the harvest, Ceres, and the holiday was called Cerealia. Cerealia was the major festival celebrated for the grain goddess Ceres in pagan Rome. Thanksgiving is in the guise of the pagan harvest festivals. That's what it is, a pagan harvest festival. And it can be traced right back to ancient Babylon and Ishtar, who is known as the goddess of fertility as well as vegetation. This is all paganism secularized and brought to us in ways that are unassuming and makes us feel it's all about family and not about the worship of other gods. But it's worship of other gods, but it's highly incorrect. We have just been accustomed to and attached to the ways of this world and how they celebrate their gods. We need to be very intentional about our celebrations and how we give thanks to Yah. This holiday is not about Yahuwah, even if it is Him you are giving thanks to when you decide to celebrate this day. We are just mixing traditions. We're mixing the Bible with the pagans and saying it's all pure because we're calling on Him. But if you don't believe me that this is not about Yahuwah, I can show you why. If this was all about Yahuwah and worshiping Him, we would do it the way He has shown us. It's not as if He hasn't talked to us about this, but what has happened in religion and these churches, they just don't teach us the way Yah has done things, the way He has shown us, and the way He desires. They just teach us how to adapt our ways of worship with the ways of the world. And that's just the wrong way of being. I mean, let's be clear. Yahuwah has already commanded His own feast days. If we were all about Him and serving Him, we wouldn't have to wonder, well, what can we do? Because He has shown us what we can do. We just don't do them. Mostly because we don't know. And guess what? This is what the churches were supposed to be teaching. But that's another story. Because the world is Christian, we do things the way that the church does things, rather than what Yahuwah has actually said in His word. Yahuwah gave three harvest feasts. The barley harvest, which we know as the Feast of Unleavened Bread. This is on the first full moon following the spring equinox. There is the wheat harvest, what we know as Pentecost. This is 50 days from the Feast of the First Fruits. And there is Sukkot, or Feast of Tabernacles, which is on the 15th day of the 7th month. This just recently passed, and this is a great feast. In Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 15, he says, 7 days you shall keep a sacred feast to Yahuwah your Elohim, in the place which Yahuwah chooses, because Yahuwah your Elohim will bless you in all your produce and all the work of your hands, so that you surely rejoice. Now that's a feast. 7 days of a great meal to honor Yah. But this Christian nation doesn't actually make this a part of our culture. So what we do is we practice cultures that stem from pagans before we ever practice what the Bible actually says. Now this is not a video to do a breakdown of the feast. The point I'm making is that we have been taught so wrong and brought up in ways that have nothing to do with our Creator.
The Pequot people were burned alive in the middle of their sleep at night in 1637. Mass Bay Colony, Plymouth Colony, Providence Plantation, Mystic Seaport, all English colonies banded together to burn women and children while they slept in a village at night. They barricaded the exit. They did not allow anyone to leave. They wanted them to burn. They were proud that they burned. This country was proud to write. We could smell their burning, rotting flesh for over a mile away. It's written, folks. Please read it on your own. I am not making this up. Stephen King can't make this up. He was so proud, the town of Norwich, Connecticut, had a statue honoring this man up until roughly a decade ago. John Mason, the man who murdered over 700 people. When anyone, the few people who were able to survive that Holocaust, they were rounded up. They were sold as slaves. Before they were sold, they were marched all the way from Connecticut to Mass Bay Colony, present-day Boston. They were placed on trial. They were declared to be sold as slaves. But before they sent them on that slave ship, they had to humiliate them some more. And they read a declaration that those people shall not ever, once again, even utter the word Pequot. They will no longer be able to call themselves a Pequot. I am proud to say, I'm a Mashituckin Pequot. This is the history, folks. Because that particular day, that particular incident, is when this country declared its second religious day of Thanksgiving. This is what we're celebrating, folks. And for all of you who took pictures of me with my nice little pilgrim head buddy here, I hope you get the story that goes with it. Because anyone who sees this, I'm sure, thinks I'm a sick, twisted individual. This is a reminder. This is what Hallmark greeting cards and Charlie Brown cartoons should be showing when we celebrate this holiday every year, when we celebrate Columbus Day every year, because this is what it represented. I'm gonna shut my mouth so we can get on way with this march through town, because we need all of you who are here to get this story out to the people. I can only visit so many schools in this time that I am here on this earth. And I can only visit those who are welcome to hearing the truth and invite me to do so. I encourage all of you to do the same. I look out and I see in this crowd, I see some people that I've been at their schools, and they are here now standing in solidarity. I really appreciate this. It means they're listening. Somebody's listening, and they don't appreciate what's going on. This symbol right here, we're going to march all the way around, and we're going to make one stop at the church where King Philip's head sat on a pole until it rotted for over 20 some odd years. For those of you who do not know who King Philip was, he was the man who started the most patriotic uprising this country will ever see, when its native people stood against these forces. And this manner of warfare, during King Philip's war, when King Philip abducted Mary Rawlinson, she reported in her own writings, she was treated with far greater respect by this savage than she was by her own people. Our women were topless. There was no rape. We did not need abortions. The word Matumwisus is what we call our women. It does not mean woman. It means she who makes all decisions. We had a high respect for our women. That was something pilgrims never understood and still does not translate into America today. Square buildings that cost us so much to heat, to build, to cool, because we're sheltering ourselves from what's going on in the natural world. I've never seen a bird build a square bird's nest. That is the most absurd thing, and Americans still repeat this European nonsense. When are we going to come up and show the rest of the world what should have always been there when we first tried to get our teachings across in the 1600s? Listen to us. We're not saying we're better. We're just saying this works in nature.
Kissing to ring in the next year of the Lord Jesus. New Year's Day is a Christian holiday, and I'm on a mission, and join me in this mission to reclaim New Year's Day as a Christian holiday. In some ways, it is the most Christian. So we just celebrated that, and we as believers must have a solid grasp on what it means that Jesus is reigning, that his kingdom has come. So I want to look at a familiar passage. It's very familiar to you now because, again, we just came through the Christmas season and you sang this, you heard it. If you saw a performance of Handel's Messiah, you are familiar with this text. And I want to use Isaiah 9 and the New Testament's interpretation of Isaiah 9 to launch us into this this short series we're going to do on the kingdom and the last days. All right, with me? I still have my coffee.
So yeah, don't be like this guy after, you know, what I just said, because, you know what, let's just give you the Bible verses. Deuteronomy 12:32 says this: "So be careful to obey all the commands I give you. You must not add anything to them or subtract anything from them." All right. And Deuteronomy 4:2, "Do not add to or subtract from these commands I am giving you. Just obey the commands of the Lord your God that I am giving you." And then Proverbs 36, "Do not add to his words or he may rebuke you and expose you as a liar." All right, and then Revelations 22:19, "And if anyone removes any of the words from this book of prophecy," which is the book of Revelations, "God will remove that person's share in the tree of life and in the holy city that are described in this book." And Ecclesiastes 3:14, "And I know that whatever God does is final. Nothing can be added to it or taken from it. God's purpose is that people should fear him." We ought to praise God. Let God not bless us, I'll teach you a lesson. And yeah, we're going to praise God. Yeah, yeah. We ought to praise God. Let God not bless us, I'll teach you a lesson. And yeah, we're going to praise God. Yeah. We ought to praise God. Let God not bless us, I'll teach you a lesson. And yeah, we're going to praise God. Yeah, yeah.